My organization of women's freedom in Iraq was founded in Baghdad in the year 2003, in the end of May. And going to June, I got together with many women, and we, just like many Iraqis, we were not supportive of the war on Iraq. And many people in the West would say, but why? You got rid of Saddam Hussein. Why not happy with this war? Just imagine you're in your house and you're being bombed, and a big military arsenal comes to your side of the world, and all the killing happens against you. It's not something to celebrate, not something to be happy about. We founded the Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq mainly because we were sure that this war will not bring freedoms to the people of Iraq, to the women of Iraq. And we also had a human rights agenda and thought we will be the watchdog for human rights, whether it be against women, against anybody else in Iraq. And as we all know, the death toll in Iraq was a very heavy one. It's very hard to know the exact number. Some figures say 1 million, some figures say 500,000, and it's, you know, when your neighbor has their son or their daughter pass away, or their grandfather, grandmother, you feel sad for months, and yet 500,000 Iraqi human lives don't make much difference. And this is strange, what the world has come to in terms of evaluating lives just because they are on the other side of the world. My organization was set to be the human rights watchdog in Iraq, and we, from 2003 until now, our idea was to map all the violations against human rights, and we took them one after the other. The first small projects that we started were about sheltering women from honor killing, because it was a tribal habit which we did not like to see in the future of Iraq, but we were not aware that we would run into big, huge violations of human rights. If we start with the ones that were written into the constitution of Iraq, you may be aware that in the year 2005, the Iraqi constitution was finalized, was passed. And if you read the introduction, you would feel you are living in the Middle Ages. You would feel somebody is pulling you down like hundreds of years back. And in Iraq, we have lived a modern life. For us to be reading a text that is extremely religious, that addresses us as religious sects, was scary. And yet we weren't aware that there are some articles in that constitution which turned women into subservients. For example, Article 41, which gave way to Islamic Sharia. Islamic Sharia was not the law in Iraq. We had personal status law, which was a combination of secular and some sources of religion. But it was a more humane one. And we were told by the US ambassador in Iraq then that it was the most democratic constitution in the region. And when you go to Article 41, you find that polygamy against women is the law, that the marriage of minors, children's marriage, is legal. And you will find that women are no longer equal to men. So a constitution was put in place that differentiates between people according to their religions and also according to gender, and does not recognize personal freedoms, individual freedoms. So that was the first violation of human rights in Iraq, put into the constitution, put into the laws, but that was not the only one, because the governmental practices against women became as such where a woman does not have the freedom to property, while we did have it under the Ba'ath regime, the previous era. And I'm not defending the Ba'ath regime. It was a bloody dictatorship which we wanted to get rid of, but not in this way. We just needed an Arab Spring to come along, and we would have been in the streets. We would have organized just like we did. in the Arab Spring in February 25, 2011 in Baghdad. That's one of the things that I will speak. The first part that I want to speak about is our legal and constitutional rights. When the Tahrir Square demonstration started in Iraq, in Baghdad specifically, 100,000 people came to the streets because they were not happy with what they faced under this government, and we were shot by the security institutions. Our offices were raided, and which told us that there is no freedom of speech, there is no freedom of peaceful assembly. In Iraq, our constitutional rights were not guaranteed. When we speak about legal and constitutional rights, these are some of the items that come to my mind, but I would like to speak about what happened to women. Trafficking was a word that we did not know what it meant in Iraq, because we have not really witnessed women to be sold and bought, just like merchandise. If we look at trafficking and the pattern that happened inside Iraq, in our organization, we began to meet with women from different parts of Baghdad, and we began to get our reports to each other. And we found out that in every specific week, there was almost 10 women who were kidnapped in a certain part of Baghdad. And when we did the math, the numbers were very scary. In the first years of the war, the trafficking of Iraqi women abroad to Syria, to the Emirates, to Amman were scary. The numbers were very big. But eventually, after we had a government and the oil money began to pour into the pockets of the officials, we found out that trafficking took another pattern. It began to get women trafficked and sold inside the country, mostly to the entertainment places, so-called entertainment places of the governmental officials. So we did a study in the year 2008 as to who are the women who are being trafficked. We have it on our website. Our website is equalityiniraq.com. It's a study on prostitution and trafficking in Iraq, and we found out that 65% of the females that are being trafficked are under 18 years old. And a big number of them, you will find it in the report, these exact figures, are orphans of war. Orphans who ended up with no family, who have lost their families, nobody is responsible of them, so they are being bought and sold to outside the country and also inside the country. At this moment, one of the NGOs in the Kurdistan of Iraq has come up with the figure that in one city there are 300 brothels. So we are speaking about a huge trafficking industry that hit Iraq after the war. And at this point, in our shelter, we find out that half the young women who are coming seeking shelter are victims of trafficking. So we try to reintegrate them into the society. We find we run into very huge difficulties. For example, we cannot get them citizenships. The officials do not acknowledge their right to basic human rights. So trafficking of women was one of the huge epidemics that hit the population in Iraq. The second one, which most people, especially the officials in Iraq, would just brush off, like they don't care for, is the systemic women's killing. Some of it called honor killing, and people think that, these are family members, they killed their daughters because they've been not honorable. So how is it any business of ours? It is business of the legislators, who were allowed to keep the honor killing articles in the law, in the criminal code, the article 409 in the criminal code 111 still finds honor killing legal. And in Iraq, during these years, until now, in every single year, there's at least 1,000 women who's being killed. We sent our delegate to the morgue of Baghdad in the end of 2010, and we were not allowed to go there afterwards. The government does not allow it. And the employee told us in every single year there's somewhere between 300 and 500 female bodies with the signature to honor killing, which could be like the hand chopped off. And ugly details that I don't want to go into now, but the legislators, the experts, the US experts who were supervising legislation did not care to repeal that article that gives the legal cover for honor killings. So systemic women's killings continues until now, and there was a huge part of it, like a huge campaign against women in the south of Iraq between the years 2007-2008, where an ambulance driver was giving us his report that every day he had to pick up a few bodies of women which were mutilated from different parts of their body. And yet it was not addressed as something issue. It was called something culture, not in need to be addressed. And the laws do not address it. What are I would like to map just a few other kinds of human rights violations before coming to the final issue of the day of the project that we're going into. In the year 2011, in February, a gay man was killed by crushing his skull with a concrete block. And that was not the only killing of its kind. It was followed with tens of killings of gay men by Islamist militia called Asa'ib al-Haq, which is a sect of Muqtada Sadr's militias in the Sadr ghetto in Baghdad. We have thousands of NGOs in Iraq. Many of them are supporters of the newly founded government, and nobody spoke a single word. We, as a women's organization, found ourselves having to step out and address the issue. And we spoke to a few LGBT people. We wrote a statement, and we had to be the whistleblowers, even when it came to the LGBT killings. And it's something that's not really addressed in the Arab world. It's not addressed properly. So that was one of the scary moments in the last 10 years, February 5, 2011. There was a smaller mass killing of LGBT in the year 2009, which we did also write into a statement, but this was a big one. And the US experts in the Green Zone did not address it. They spoke to us, they spoke to the ministries, but nothing was done about it. And eventually they, inside the Green Zone, a new name come was called emo killings. What's emo? You ask any Iraqi, what's the meaning of emo? Nobody knows. But they had to bring a cover up so it's not called gay killings, and so it doesn't come under the category of a human rights abuse. And this really got us upset, because it could have helped the movement, like building a movement of LGBT people, but they found a way, a way to stop it from building. Sectarian oppression was there all the way along, and it didn't just happen by itself. We weren't Sunnis and Shias from the beginning of time. I come from a mixed family. We never thought who was my father or my mother was Sunni or was Shia. But when the US occupation happened, the administration was speaking to Iraqis according to their religious sect, their religious ID, and even representation of people into political groups was done accordingly. And the Sunni sect was being punished because it was thought of as those who protected Saddam Hussein. Well, it was not right. Saddam Hussein discriminated against everybody. He didn't know Sunni from Shia. He discriminated against all of us. So the US occupation of Iraq did not only have to kill people, but it set a political formula to set us against each other and keep on killing each other. And this continues in Iraq, and the possibility of having a functional government under such a political formula is almost impossible. In my organization, organization, we know that we cannot get much rights by lobbying with the government, which is an extremely religious government. We know that we need to organize women in different parts of Iraq so as to get the women's power growing, empowered, and they have we have our position on everything. So we do send women to, we have a branch in the south, in Basra. We also have a branch in the west, in Samarra, and we also sent a delegate to the town of Hawija. The reason we sent our delegate to that town is that we understood that it was under the influence of Al-Qaeda, organization, and the battles that have happened there between Al-Qaeda and the U.S. were devastating for the people. So we thought, let's talk to the women, see how they're doing there. And we went to visit the public places there. One of the places we went to visit was the hospital. And we were invited to go into a hall where we found children, a big number of children on the floor, like crawling because their limbs are not working. The arms do not work, the legs do not work, and they cannot talk, these children. So when we began to ask the questions, why are these children like this, we understood that they live right next to a big U.S. military base where there was daily ammunition training for the last many years, since 2003. And we understood that ammunition training means that you fire your, I don't know, machine guns or what is it, bigger ammunition into the air, and there are some chemicals that are go into the air and go into the water and go to downstream the river to where Hawija is, where people drink the water. And eventually this area is contaminated. So we began to ask the questions, how many children are suffering from the same disability? In the first visit, we were given a list of 355. And most of them, 90% of them, were the same case. And when we asked for more, are there more cases? We want to do something about it. Now the number, I'm told, at this point, is gone over 800. And this is a small town of 109,000 population. For the this kind of disability to rise 20 times more than it used to be before the war, this is a big question to be asked. And we put it into a report with the listings of the children, and we released it online, and it was caught on this side of the world. It was caught by some people who think this is not right. Children should not come to life disabled. Their mother is unable to take care of them. And when both parents take care of them, nobody can work. They live in extreme poverty. And we're speaking about big areas of Iraq. We found out that the same has happened in Fallujah, but with the difference that it happened much more severely. The contamination was by white phosphorus, and the children have come to life missing organs, sometimes with one eye. You must have seen those pictures. And the addition to it is that in Basra also, hundreds of children have come to life with an opening in their back, and they weren't alive in the first place. So we found that at this moment, the society is going through a big ordeal that was not there before this occupation. In Hawija, these people are living around a U.S. military base where there was daily ammunition training. In Fallujah, they were practically living in battlefields where all sorts of materials have been used in these battles, and it was acknowledged that white phosphorus was used, but the Iraqi government did not want the report to go out, otherwise they will need to set up cancer hospitals. And in Basra, where most of the battles happened in the beginning of the occupation, that's also another hotspot where a big number of children have had birth defects. At this point, and after having heard from the Center for Constitutional Rights and the Iraq Veterans Against War, and knowing what this war has done to them, to us, and what a big number of people around the world world would not want such a crazy war to be launched again anywhere in the world. We put our hands into each other's hands and we feel that this campaign needs to be launched in order to control the destiny of people around the world. And I have asked this question before today. I asked it to Deborah. Would a selection of the smartest human rights defendants be able to stop the next war from being launched from here? I don't know, but this campaign is definitely one way of trying to do it. Holding those who started the war on false pretext accountable, responsible, and we all know if nobody pays the price, it will happen again. Reparations for all who were injured by this war on Iraq, all who were injured inside the Iraq Veterans Against War will need to be paid and will need to be quantified and paid.